Greg Louganis is considered to be the greatest diver who ever lived. Top diving coaches say there will never be another one like him. He's won an incredible 47 national titles, 5 world championships, and 5 Olympic diving medals, winning consecutive double gold medals in 1984 and 1988. An unprecedented achievement. At the 1988 Olympics in Seoul, Korea, Louganis stole the hearts of the world when he hit his head on the 3-meter springboard and then went on to win 2 gold medals. The world was at his feet, but what people didn't know was that Greg Louganis, 4-time Olympic gold medalist, was one of the unhappiest men alive. For Louganis and his coach, Ron O'Brien, had kept a terrible secret.
On my reverse 2.5 pike, I knew as soon as I was coming off the board that I was going to be close, because I could feel it in my own body. So what I was concerned about is hitting my hands. So I came out wide so that the board would, you know, go by and I wouldn't hit it. You know, I started coming out of the dive, and then I heard this big hollow thud. And then I found myself in the water. I just held my head in hopes to, I didn't know if I was cut or not, but I just wanted to hold the blood in, or, you know, just not anybody touch it.
You hit your head, mm-hmm. and there may have been blood in the water. Mm-hmm. Why were you terrified?
Because Ron O'Brien and myself were one of the few people in the stands that knew that I was HIV positive.
You were in the 1988 Olympics HIV positive. Mm-hmm. Tonight is the first time Louganis has publicly admitted that he is HIV positive. He has written about this in his just published autobiography, Breaking the Surface. Louganis, now 35, is retired from diving and lives in the hills of Malibu with his 5 Great Danes. The story of Greg Louganis does not begin or end with the 88 Olympics, nor with the admission that he is HIV positive. The story of Greg Louganis was an epic almost from the day he was born. From a very early age, Louganis had trouble identifying just who he was. Born to a Samoan father and Northern European mother, both 15 at the time, Gregory Louganis was adopted at the age of 9 months by Peter Louganis, a bookkeeper, and his wife, Frances. He was their 2nd adopted child. They also had a daughter, Despina. Greg and his sister were raised in a middle-class suburb of San Diego. His incredible acrobatic talent became apparent before he was even 2 years old. From the beginning, all through his life, his mother was his greatest ally.
My mother got my sister enrolled in some dance classes. And I would get bored sitting in the waiting room, and so I'd start, you know, copying what they were doing. If they were dancing or doing some tumbling, then, you know, I'd mimic what they were doing.
He seemed to love it.
And then when Greg performed, you made his costumes?
Every one of them.
Sequins and all the whole nine yards. It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. It was a good growing experience, too.
How did Greg begin to dive?
We had purchased a home, and we put a pool in the back with just a regular diving board. And he was down there doing cartwheels off of the diving board. And I saw him, and I was afraid he had hurt himself. So I asked my husband if I could give him lessons if he wanted them. And he said, sure. So I asked Greg, and he said, yes.
At the age of 12, Louganis won the Junior Olympics, his first major national title. But he had started competing in local meets when he was just 9. It was at that age that Ron O'Brien, later Louganis' Olympic coach, first saw him dive.
He performed dives with an interpretation that was different than anybody else. And you could just see it when he was 9 years old. He was far above anybody I ever saw at that age.
In spite of Louganis' tremendous acrobatic talent and great diving potential, his childhood was not a happy time.
There was a point in my early adolescence that, you know, I grew up knowing that I was adopted. My skin was darker than the rest of the kids at my school. I was called a lot of names.
Like?
Sissy, nigger, retard. I had a very difficult time with reading.
You were dyslexic.
Yes,
but you didn't know it.
Yeah. I didn't find out about dyslexia until I was a freshman in college, and it was like, oh my God, it's me. I'm not retarded. You know, I'm not the moron that I thought I was.
I'd see him come home from school, and I could almost tell you the way he felt and what he was going to do when he walked in the door.
Was he a sad little boy?
Mm-hmm.
You must have felt terrible.
I did.
What was your husband like with Greg?
He had nothing to do with Greg until Greg started winning first place. Then he stepped in. He never played with him. He never took him any place. He wasn't a role model for my son.
Peter Louganis died of cancer in 1991. By that time, Greg had finally made his peace with his father. But when Greg was a little boy, he was very hurt by his father's neglect.
That's where gymnastics, dance, and diving was my salvation, because it was something that I was excelling in. And, you know, if it's your entire self-esteem is based on, you know, how your diving workout went, you know, because you didn't feel that you had anything else to offer, I mean, that's how important it was to me. And that was how important it was to be successful.
Greg, by 12 years old, pre-adolescent, you were already a very depressed kid, you write.
Mm-hmm.
So depressed that you tried suicide.
Mm-hmm. You know, I believe a lot of suicides, I mean, you don't die of committing suicide, you die of sadness. And I understood that I was so sad, it hurt.
You took pills?
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't work, fortunately.
And it didn't work. And I was like, damn it, you can't do anything right.
Where did you get the fire in your belly to keep going when really you were a depressed kid?
My salvation was diving, because then I could focus on that. And unfortunately, I mean, if I had a bad workout, I had a bad day. If I had a good workout, I had a great day. I could deal with anything. So it was a lot of high highs and low lows.
How was it?
I think that was all right.
I thought it was terrific.
I'm still pulling a little bit too hard.
When you were training, how many dives did you do a day? How many hours? What was it like?
Sometimes I think we would do upwards close to 100 dives a day.
You're your toughest critic.
Yeah.
It's a good thing you weren't a judge. You'd still be at the 88 Olympics diving.
I'd still be in my first workout.
Louganis's most difficult dive is a reverse 3.5 off the 10-meter platform. To give you some idea of what it's like, it's the equivalent of jumping from a 3-story building, doing 3.5 somersaults in less than 3 seconds, and landing headfirst in the water at 32 miles an hour.
Do you say something to yourself?
I hear you sing something to yourself. When
yeah.
You're there.
Yeah. The song that's always been a real standby for me is Believe in Yourself from The Wiz.
What are the words?
If you believe within your heart, you'll know that nobody can change the path that you go.
He's got the silver for sure. Oh, great finish, Greg.
If it was like a real tight competition and I knew that everything depended on this last dive, then I'd always say no matter what happens, my mother's still going to love me.
Both Louganis' mother and father came with him to the 1976 Olympics in Montreal. He was, at the age of 16, the youngest diver at the Games. He came in second and won a silver medal. He was an Olympic wonder boy, but to himself, a miserable failure.
I won the Olympic silver medal. I didn't go there to take second. I went there to win. And so I felt like I let my coach down, my family down, my country down.
In 1976, during mm-hmm. those Olympics, you came to terms with something else in your own mind.
Yeah. I don't think that I had come to terms with my sexuality, my sexual orientation, but I was understanding what it was.
You realize you were homosexual.
Right.
And that you had known this somehow or other since you were a very little boy.
Since I was a little boy, yeah. Yeah. I knew I was different, and I didn't understand what that difference was.
Did the other people on the team know you were gay?
I didn't try and hide it. I didn't try to have any false life or anything like that. On some of the trips, it was really hard.
Did they shun you?
Yeah. Nobody would room with me. I mean, I was lucky to find one person on the team that would room with me.
But it wasn't publicly known. The United States boycotted the 1980 Olympics in Moscow to protest the Soviet Union's invasion of Afghanistan. But by 1984, Greg Louganis, at the age of 24, was in the best shape of his life, ready to compete and hungry for the gold. Louganis fulfilled expectations. He won the gold medal on the 3-meter springboard and then went on to win another gold in platform diving.
Is your gold medal winner in great style.
Louganis's Olympic achievements should have led to major lucrative endorsement deals, but he only got one. When everybody else was getting endorsements, the only endorsement that you really got was from Speedo. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's because other people, other advertisers, whatever companies, thought you were gay?
I think that was... I'm sure that it was definitely an assumption that I was, and that's, I believe, the reason why people stayed away from me.
In Louganis's private life, there was little joy. During this time, he was involved in a relationship with a man who physically and verbally abused him. Louganis prefers to call him Tom, not his real name, to protect his privacy. He was your manager, your lover, and awful to you. He stole your money,
yeah.
Hit you, took you years before you kicked him out.
Yeah.
Why did you take this abuse from this Tom?
I thought I deserved it. But I didn't think that I had anything else to offer other than my diving. Who else would have me?
By 1988, things were looking up for Louganis as he eagerly anticipated the 1988 Olympic Games in Seoul, Korea. He was poised to sweep the diving events and win two more gold medals. But 6 months prior to the Games, Louganis got the news that Tom was dying of AIDS. Louganis then had himself tested. Shortly thereafter, his personal physician delivered the devastating news that Louganis himself was HIV positive. He was then put on AZT, a powerful drug with potentially dangerous side effects, and every 4 hours, day and night, he had to take his pills. But that wasn't the only problem.
Dealing with the HIV was really difficult for me because I felt like, God, the U.S. Olympic Committee needs to know this. U.S. diving needs to know it, because what if I get sick at the Olympic Games and are unable to compete? I didn't anticipate hitting my head on the board. I didn't anticipate, blood. That's something that I didn't think about at the time.
But you didn't tell the Olympic Committee. You
No.
didn't tell anyone.
I was encouraged not to.
By whom?
By the small team of people.
Your doctor, your coach?
Doctor, coach.
I think it's a personal matter.
You weren't afraid that Greg might hurt himself, or that he might hit his head in the board and there'd be blood? He might infect someone else?
No, not really, because there's very, very little chance. If we were in a sport like boxing, or wrestling, mm-hmm. football, where there's a lot of contact, personal contact, I would have been very concerned. But our sport is such that you don't ever come close to anybody.
And when you hit your head, and there was blood perhaps in that water, what did you think?
That's where I became paralyzed with fear, because, I knew that there was not too much of a chance, because it takes a while. If you cut yourself on your head, usually it takes a minute to start, bleeding. And, there is chlorine in the pool all over, the deck's wet with chlorinated water.
And that would wipe out any of the virus?
Right. And if there was blood in the pool, there's a delusion effect that, the virus is so small and there's, hundreds of thousands of gallons of water, that it's being diluted by.
Olympic physician Dr. Jim Puffer stitched up a 2-inch cut in Louganis' head without wearing protective gloves. Did you tell the doctor?
No. I was so stunned. What was going on in my mind at the time was, what's my responsibility? Do I say something? This has been an incredibly guarded secret. It could, throw the entire competition into, a state of alarm, even more so than just having hit my head on the board. I was paralyzed with fear.
I told him after we got in the back room, if you want to quit right now, Greg, it's fine. You've had a wonderful career. You've done tremendous things. It's strictly up to you.
After being stitched up, Louganis had only 5 minutes to decide whether to do his next dive in order to remain in the competition.
He said, we've worked too long and too hard to come this far and not continue. Yes, I want to continue if I can. He wasn't going to give it up.
Louganis got right back up on the 3-meter springboard and qualified for the finals.
Yes!
What an athlete!
And then the very next day, to everyone's astonishment and joy, won the gold medal.
Yes!
What a dive! That is the best dive he's done so far.
But Louganis wasn't finished. He still had to compete in the 10-meter platform.
This is the situation. Zhang Ni first, Greg Louganis second.
Before his very last dive, he was in second place. To win, he needed near-perfect scores on the most difficult dive in Olympic competition, a reverse 3.5.
When he stood up there on his last dive, needing great scores on the most difficult dive he did, everything that we had done for 10 years was wrapped up in that.
After you did that last dive, you put your arms around Ron O'Brien, trainer. You hugged him, and you started to sob.
Yeah.
What'd you say?
I said that nobody will ever know what we've just been through.
It's a hell of a way to do it.
In all the years since, Louganis has kept the secret not only from the public, but from the doctor who stitched him up at the Olympics. What do you say to people who say, Greg, you could have been endangering lives of the other divers and of the doctor? What do you say to them?
That's really hard. That was probably one of the most difficult conversations that I've ever had.
When?
Like 6 years later. I had assumed that being a doctor and dealing with blood and that sort of thing, that he would be tested. And he didn't get tested until I told him. And I knew his family. I danced with his wife. He's not just a doctor.
And he's fine.
And he's fine.
But you didn't know that for 6 years.
No.
Greg.
That was... incredible guilt, irresponsible.
You didn't have to tell anyone this.
I know.
You're telling it. You are now admitting for the first time that you are HIV positive.
Mm-hmm.
Speedo endorses you, has endorsed you in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Does that company know that you are HIV positive?
I had a conversation with the owner of Speedo, Linda Wachner, and I went to her, and the conversation was amazing to me.
You told her?
I told her that I was HIV positive. She wanted to know, make sure that I was being taken care of properly, that I was talking to the right people. Her concern was with me.
Were you re-signed by Speedo?
We negotiated. We have a contract through 96.
And they still endorse you?
And they still endorse me.
How are you today?
I'm doing okay. I'm doing all right. Health-wise, you know, everything seems to be stable and that sort of thing. I still have bouts with depression, but I'm working on that.
Do you have AIDS?
According to the CDC standards of AIDS versus HIV, I do have AIDS.
Is this the first time that you've admitted that you have AIDS?
Yes.
You did not have to write this book. You did not have to admit that you're HIV positive.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you doing it?
I wanted my story to, you know, to motivate, you know, those people who are HIV positive to be responsible and also to, you know, to understand that life isn't over yet. You know, that HIV and AIDS is not a death sentence. And you can achieve.
You can even win Olympic medals.
Yeah. Some people don't think that AIDS has touched their lives. A lot of people saw me at the Olympics and they were cheering for me. So now all of those people can't say that they have not been affected by AIDS.
All of those people. What pressure on him during the dives in the, at the Olympics and since then? On the blood in the pool, experts say that there was no real risk to other divers there because, for one thing, chlorine is a viricide and also it needs a bloodstream to be in. But there is a controversy now as to whether he should have alerted the Olympic authorities.
Well, remember, he only had 5 minutes from the time he did that dive when he hit his head to make the biggest decision of his life, and diving is his salvation. But we checked with the International Olympic Committee, and they said that Greg was under no obligation to divulge his secret even after he hit his head on the board. The risk of transmission of the virus is extremely low, and that they're able to deal with spilled blood should there be any, nor will they change their position. They said it's not just a matter of privacy, but if you tested, it would lead to mass hysteria and suspicion and so on. And that's their definitive answer.
He looks good, though. His hair isn't short because of any.
No, he just did that because he felt like it. But I want to read what Steve McFarlane, the president of U.S. Diving, said. He said, this man is a great champion. The person that people saw when Greg dived was a humble, self-effacing, genuine person, and we should all root for him in this fight against a new opponent. He's going to be off publicizing his autobiography, talking about this. He'll be in Good Morning America live on Monday. People can see him then. And I don't have to tell Greg what we wish him.
We sure do wish him well. Thank you, Barbara.